Welcome. This is video 2 on fair valuation. In video 1, we defined hedgeable claims. Let us repeat what we mean with a hedgeable claim. And in this video, we will also define other types of claims, orthogonal claims and hybrid claims. But first, what was a hedgeable claim? A hedgeable claim, SH, is an element of the set of all claims such that there exists a trading strategy, let us call it mu, such that SH is mu times Y. So that means SH is a hedgeable claim if there exists a trading strategy in U with time one value mu times Y equal to SH. This was a hedgeable claim. But in an insurance context, we will also need, or we will also have access to other kinds of claims. The first one that we define is an orthogonal claim. In some sense, an orthogonal claim is just the opposite, in some sense, as a hedgeable claim. We say that a claim is orthogonal, and we will denote it by S orthogonal, if it is P independent of the traded claims Y1 to Yn. So what does that mean? It means that the claim is independent of any financial information that will be available at time one. And the financial information that will be available at time one, this is exactly Y1 to Yn. So we will denote this by S orthogonal is orthogonal to Y1 to Yn. So an orthogonal claim, in fact, the outcome of that claim has nothing to do with the outcome of the financial market at time one. Or if we know something about the outcome of the financial market at time one, that will not influence or have no influence on the orthogonal claim. Examples are, for instance, the claims of an automobile insurance portfolio at time one. So this will maybe, in general, have nothing to do with the financial market evaluation. Because they cannot be hedged, that means that such claims must be buffered by capital. So if we have to value them, there will be an expectation plus a risk margin. The linear space of all orthogonal claims will be denoted by C orthogonal. Now, remark, the question is, are there claims which are both hedgeable and at the same time also orthogonal? Think of it, the answer is yes. Any risk-free claim, a real number, is hedgeable and also orthogonal. This risk-free claim can be hedged by zero coupon bond investment, and it's also orthogonal because it is independent of the financial market information. These are the only claims, the risk-free claims, that are both hedgeable and orthogonal. Let us now, as an example, as an illustration of orthogonal claims, let us look at the cost of capital principle. Or the cost of capital principle is a way to value orthogonal claims. So we consider a portfolio of N insurance policies with respective claims X1, X2, XN elements of C. Now we make some assumptions. The assumptions that we make are, under the measure P, the XIs, the individual claims, are independent identically distributed. So all the claims of the individual policies are independent identically distributed. The mean is mu, and the variance is sigma squared. Each XI is orthogonal to Y1 to Yn, so that means XII is an orthogonal claim. And we will also assume that N is sufficiently large, such that the sum of all claims related to the individual policies can be assumed to be approximately normal. In reality, this will never be satisfied, but we make it here because it's a theoretical, we make this assumption here because it's a theoretical example and to make the exercise a little bit nicer. So what is the insurance portfolio liability related to the claims X1 to XN? It's simply S orthogonal is sum I is 1 to N XI. Now, let us introduce the cost of capital principle. We want to value rho s orthogonal as follows. We will say rho s orthogonal is e to the power minus r expectation under p of s orthogonal plus a risk margin. The expectation under p of s orthogonal, we had a name already for that. That is the best estimate for s orthogonal. And the risk margin is the risk margin determined according now to the cost of capital principle. So the risk margin is I times, and what is I? I is a pyrenage, that means I is a value between 0 and 1. So for instance, I is 0.10, that means I is 10%. And I times a difference, and the difference is the value at risk at level P of S orthogonal, and P is, for instance, 99.5%, so we want to be 99.5% sure to be able to pay, minus the expectation under P of S orthogonal. And this for a given probability level and a pyrenage, I. So what does this mean now, in fact, this risk margin? If we price the claim as a best estimate, then we have already the expectation available. But now, as a risk margin, suppose for the moment that I is 1. Then we add the value at risk minus the expectation. So we have the expectation plus the value at risk minus the expectation. If I is 1 or 100%, then in fact, the price that we charge, the value, is in fact the 99.5%. If we charge that premium, we will be sure with 99.5% probability that we can pay all claims. Of course, this is not a realistic premium or valuation. That would mean that we charge almost the maximum possible value of the claim as an insurance premium. An insurance premium that charges the maximum possible claim or almost the maximum possible claim, well, we cannot sell such in contract. How does the insurance industry can solve this? By introducing owners of the company. And the owners of the company tell now, okay, you charge your client the expectation. And on top of that, we want to be sure with 99.5% that we can pay. So we will need the value at risk at level 99.5 minus the expectation. But the client doesn't have to pay this. I am the owner of the company, I will set aside this capital. The difference between the value at risk and the expectation, I will take it from my pocket, put it in the company. If it goes wrong, if the expectation is not enough, you can pay more claims from this difference. So that will be bad for the owners of the company, for the shareholders. But if it goes well, if the claims are less than this expectation, the gain is also for me, for the owner of the company. Of course, a shareholder doesn't want to do this for free, so he will charge an interest. I is, for instance, 10%. So in the end, to summarize, I charge the client the expectation plus the cost, 10%, of the amount that I have to set aside as owner of the company. In any case, this amount is something for my pocket, in my pocket as the owner of the company. And I can even earn more in case the value at risk is not, sorry, in case the claims are smaller than the expectation. If this I is, for instance, 10%, that means that we can charge a premium, which is the expectation, plus only 10% of this deviation. So much lower premium is possible, but it's the shareholders, the owners of the company, that take that risk and that want to be paid for that by this pyrenage, by this 10%. The question now is, let us determine rho of S orthogonal, the value of the portfolio liability, and show that the value per policy, rho S orthogonal divided by N, is a decreasing function of N. So we have N policies together, they are all independent, identically distributed. We first price the whole liability, and then The liability is divided by the number of policyholders and everybody pays 1 over n. And this is 1 over n, sorry, of rho of S orthogonal. And this is a decreasing function of n. So that means the larger the group of insureds, the lower the premium for the same probability level. Let's have a look at the solution to that exercise. So rho S of S orthogonal. Rho of S orthogonal is, by definition, as we assumed, the discounted expectation of S orthogonal, so the best estimate, plus the risk margin, which is based on the cost of capital principle. Now we can calculate the expectation of S orthogonal, that's n times mu, and the variance of S orthogonal is n times sigma squared, because we have n independent, identically distributed risks. And now we have to calculate the value at risk at level P of S orthogonal. What is the value at risk? Actually, the value at risk is in fact at level P, if this is here. If we here have the distribution function, the cumulative distribution function of S orthogonal, we take level P and we look what point corresponds to level P. And that's the value at risk at level P of S orthogonal. So if P is 99.5%, this amount is, with this amount, you are for 99.5% sure that you will be able to pay. So if we now calculate this value at risk, this is a kind of calculation, you can do it on your own, and we find that the value at risk at level P of the portfolio liability is n times mu plus square root n sigma, and then the quantile at level P of the standard normal distribution. Phi is the is a notation that we use for the standard normal distribution. Then, if now we have the value at risk here, and we can add this in our formula, and after working it out, we find that rho S orthogonal divided by n, so the premium to be paid per policyholder, is e to the power minus r mu. That's the best estimate for every policy that remains the same, and it's independent of the size of the portfolio, plus then a second term, and this second term has a factor 1 over square root n. So the price that each policyholder pays is a decreasing function of n. If n decreases, it decreases, although the probability level remains the same. So therefore, it's good to go to a big insurer, an insurer with a large n, because the risk margin that you will have to pay for having the same probability level P, so that all claims can be paid, is a decreasing function of n. It decreases with n. And we see here, if n goes to infinity, then rho S orthogonal divided by n is in fact only equal to the best estimate. Okay, but that's of course a theoretical case. Okay, let us now continue. Well, here is another way to prove that the value at risk at level P of S orthogonal is equal to n times mu plus this square root n term. Just have a look at it yourself. Now, we have defined hedgeable claims, we have defined orthogonal claims, but there are also other claims, and this, all the rest, we will call them hybrid claims. Let us try to illustrate this by Venn diagrams. So we have the set of all hedgeable claims. We denoted this by CH. We have the set of all orthogonal claims. We denoted that by C orthogonal. We know that the intersection of the set of hedgeable and orthogonal claims only contains the constant claims. So for instance, a constant A is a claim that is hedgeable and orthogonal. And now we look at the set of all claims. The set of all claims is this set, which we call C. And so we find that a hybrid claim, for instance, S is a hybrid claim if it is here. So S is a S is a hybrid claim if it is not hedgeable nor orthogonal. And these claims like SH, this will be the interesting ones to price. How do we have to price this? Because for the hedgeable claims and for orthogonal claims, we have like a financial valuation or an actuarial valuation respectively. For the hybrid claims, we will have a kind of combination of both. Now, if we look at the sum of a hedgeable and an orthogonal claim here. So S, let's say, is the sum of a hedgeable claim and an orthogonal claim. If this is the case, for such a claim, what is the hedgeable part? Very clearly, the hedgeable part is SH. And what is the orthogonal part here? So if we have a sum of a hedgeable and an orthogonal claim, it's very easy to detect what is the hedgeable part. Then we put the price of the hedge for this, and in evaluating S, here we have the financial market price of SH, plus then an actuarial principle, for instance, the cost of capital principle for the rest. If you look at the Solvency II regulation, it is very clear how you have to price such sums of a hedgeable and an orthogonal claim. Only thing is, such claims, sums of a hedgeable and an orthogonal claim, do not appear in practice. In practice, you have much more something like this, the product of a hedgeable and an orthogonal claim. As an example, you could have, for instance, that SH is just the price, SH is just the price of a stock. For instance, FSH is Y1, and S orthogonal is, for instance, equal to sum I is 1 to N, N is the number of insureds, XI, and XI itself is, for instance, equal to 0 or 1, whether the insured dies or survives. So this is a kind of unit-linked product where the claim that is paid is the value of the stock Y1, and the orthogonal part is in fact 0 or 1, the sums of the 0 and 1s, or you pay the total claims, this you pay the stocks only to the number of survivors, all the ones, all the XIs for which the outcome is 1. Now some remarks. First of all, insurance regulation allows different approaches for evaluating hybrid claims. Why is that the case? Because here, the Solvency II regulation told us, this article that we read in video 1, you take out the hedgeable part and you price it by the price of the hedge. But what is the hedgeable part here? Because we have a product, you cannot just, there are different ways to detect the hedgeable part. You can choose on different ways on what is the hedgeable part and what is the remaining part. As we said before, for the sum, it is clear. For the product, it is not. Second remark, insurance securitization may lead to hybrid liabilities for insurers. What does that mean? Suppose that I'm a life insurer paying claims to all the people, paying an amount of money to all the people who die in my portfolio over the coming year. Now, in principle, the deaths, the mortality in my portfolio is independent of the financial market. But suppose now suddenly there comes a cat bond on the financial market, a catastrophic mortality bond, with mortality correlated or identical to the one in my insurance, life insurance portfolio. If that is the case, then the mortality in my life insurance portfolio is not orthogonal anymore, but it depends on the financial market. In particular, it depends on the cat bond. So we are living in a world where insurance securitization is growing. So that means that we have more and more hybrid liabilities, so more difficult liabilities to price. Let us now look at a third exercise, decomposing insurance liabilities. This is an exercise that we will repeat later And we will call it an exercise 3 prime, an exercise 3 double prime. And we make it each time a little bit more complex, or we make the dependency structure more realistic. Here, we are now with the simplest case. In the simplest case, we have a portfolio of N insurance contracts, and the payoff of contract I at time 1 is given by SH multiplied by XI. So again, as we said before, SH could be, for instance, be equal to Y1, the value of stock 1, or something more complicated, and XI could be, for instance, 0 or 1, whether the insured dies or survives. So that's a unit-linked contract. But now we make some important assumptions. We assume, well, SH is of course the head of a claim, but the XIs, we assume that the XIs are all P-independent identically distributed orthogonal claims. So what do we mean? P-independent means they are independent under the measure P and they are all identically distributed. It's important to mention that they are independent under what measure? We mean here under the physical measure P. In presentation 1 on financial valuation, we have seen that a P independence does not necessarily mean a Q independence. But here in the real world, under the physical probability measure, we assume that there is independence. And moreover, that all these claims are orthogonal. So that means all their outcome, or if we have this case as a special case, all their survival or not, is independent of what happens in the financial market. What is now our insurance portfolio liability? Our insurance portfolio liability is SH multiplied by S orthogonal divided by N, with S orthogonal is the sum over all XIs, which is of course an orthogonal claim because all the XIs are assumed to be orthogonal. Now, this insurance portfolio liability, we will look at the insurance portfolio liability per policy. So SH multiplied by S orthogonal N is the total insurance portfolio liability. We divide it by the number of insureds. We can split it in YH plus YDN in a sum, in an additive decomposition, where there is a factor, a random variable YH and YDN involved. The YH looks like this. Is SH multiplied by the expectation of X1. This is a hedgeable claim, of course. Why is this hedgeable? Expectation of XN is a number. For instance, it's, for instance, 1 over 2. So we have 1 over 2 times a hedgeable claim is also a hedgeable claim. So this part is definitely hedgeable. We have to buy a number of times the hedge for SH, and how many times do we have to buy it? Expectation under P of XN. Then the rest is YDN is defined in this way as H multiplied by S orthogonal divided by N minus the expectation of X1. Why can we say that this is the rest if we first have the hedgeable claim? For the following reason. Add YH and YDN, add them, and you will indeed see that we have SH multiplied by S orthogonal divided by N. Why is this hybrid claim? Well, this is a hybrid claim because it's not hedgeable. We cannot hedge it, but it's also not orthogonal because there is a hedgeable part involved. Why is it diversifiable? Well, we say that it's diversifiable because if the portfolio becomes infinitely large, this randomness, this random variable will disappear. What do we mean with disappear? We have to look a little bit more, express that a little bit more here. Well, let us, for instance, just look at the variance. If you look at the variance of YDN under P, then you can prove that it is equal to 1 over N times expectation of SH squared multiplied by the variance under P of XN. We will prove that in a moment. But important is that this variance of YDN contains a factor 1 over N. So that means if our portfolio becomes very large, this factor will become smaller and smaller and will in the end disappear. We still have to show this, and let us try to show this. Here, The variance of ydn, that's question one. The variance of ydn here is the variance of this part. And now we use what we call Eve's rule. The variance is the variance of the conditional expectation plus the expectation of the conditional variance. And the conditioning variable that we use is y, so that's the financial market information available at time one. If we work this out, we will in the end find that this variance is a over n with a expectation of sh squared multiplied by the variance of x1. So this is indeed a factor 1 over n that disappears if our portfolio becomes larger and larger. Okay. Now, we have proven that the variance of ydn converges to zero. But we can say a somewhat stronger result. We can say more in the following way. We can say it explain our diversification in terms of convergence in probability. What is convergence in probability? We will say, or we say that a sequence of random variables converges in probability to a random variable x, and we will denote that by xn converges in probability to x. We add the p above the arrow. If for any epsilon that we choose, and we look at the difference between xn and x, the absolute difference, well, the probability that this difference is larger than epsilon, if n is sufficiently large, then it goes to zero. So whatever, how small we want xn to be close to x, or how large we want xn, sorry, how small we want xn to be close to x, the probability that it is outside this ball with distance epsilon, well, in probability this goes to zero, for sure, if we make our portfolio sufficiently large. Now, the question two is, use now Chebyshev's inequality to show that y1d, y2d, y3d, the diversifiable random variables that we defined on the previous slide for different values of the numbers of matured, prove that this converges in probability to zero. Okay. Well, let us first try to prove that. So if we look at Chebyshev's inequality, Chebyshev's inequality tells us this, that the probability that ydn minus the expectation of ydn in absolute value exceeds k times the standard deviation of ydn is always smaller of or equal to 1 over k squared, and this holds for any real k. So now we know that the expectation of ydn, if you calculate it, is zero. So we get the probability that the absolute value of ydn exceeds k times square root a divided by n. The a divided by n was the standard deviation, was the variance of ydn, is smaller than 1 over k squared. Now we take a special choice for the k. We take k equal to epsilon times square root n over a. We fill this in, and then we find the probability that the absolute value of ydn exceeds epsilon is smaller than a over n times epsilon squared here. So what does that mean? That means if we take the limit for n going to infinity here of a over n squared, it's equal to zero, or that's just the definition of this conversion probability. We have found that ydn converges in probability to zero. Okay. So again, we have proven now that ydn converges in probability to zero. Now let us have a look. We can prove also that sh multiplied by s orthogonal divided by n, or what is this? That's the claim per policy, converges in probability to sh multiplied by the expectation of x1. Well, in order to prove that this holds, check this with this definition of the convergence in probability, And you will see that stating this or stating this, it's in fact the same. So saying that YDN converges in probability to zero is exactly the same as stating that the claim per policy converges to SH multiplied by the expectation of XN, X1. And now there arrives a special case that we all know very well. It's the law of large numbers, or to be more precise, the weak law of large numbers tells us that S orthogonal divided by N converges in probability to the expectation of X1. How do we see this from this result? If we just take here SH equal to 1, then this, if SH equal to 1, we get this result. So S orthogonal divided by N converges in probability to its expectation. That's the law of large numbers. One remark, we assume here that we have a sum of independent identically distributed random variables, which are orthogonal. But of course, the orthogonality assumption is not needed here. For the weak law of large numbers, as a sum of independent identically distributed random variables divided by the number of random variables will always converge to its expectation. Okay. Then, in the remainder of this exercise, we will now assume that XI is 0 or 1. XI is 0 if the insured dies before time 1, and XI is 1 in case the insured is alive at time 1. So now we have a kind of realer, more realistic unit-linked contract where there is paid SH, a hedgeable claim, in case the insured survives. And let us assume the survivor probability is P. The question is now, derive an expression for the variance of YDN. Well, this is simple to do. Let us have a look. Okay. And then we have to calculate the variance of YDN. The general formula was this one here. But now this variance of X1 is simple because X1 is a Bernoulli random variable. X1 is 0 or 1. So we can calculate the variance of X1, and this turns to be P times 1 minus P. If we fill this expression here, we find indeed that the variance of YDN is 1 over N expectation of SH squared multiplied by P multiplied by 1 minus P. Okay. So this is the end of exercise 3, in which we assumed that we have a product of a hedgeable claim and an orthogonal claim. Our liability is the product of the hedgeable and an orthogonal claim. In exercise 3 prime, which will be considered in video 3, we will make the situation a little bit more complex in terms of dependencies. We will assume here that there exists a random variable Z with support A such that conditionally X1 given Z is set are, and Xn given Z is set are independent identically distributed. So we relax the assumption that we have a portfolio of independent distributed random variables. If it's in the Bernoulli case with outcome 0 or 1, whether the insured dies or survives, we will assume that survival is not independent. In reality, survival will be more or less dependent, but we will assume that conditionally on some extra random variable, there is independence. But that's more for the next video. Thank you.